Philippine Senator Laila De Lima is back at her detention cell in Camp Crame following a three-day medical furlough. Doctors say tests done on De Lima showed no evidence that she suffered a stroke. They say that the general weakness and the migraines she was experiencing may have been triggered by the summer heat and by the poor ventilation in her detention cell. In other news, the Makati City Prosecutor's Office junks the rape with homicide complaint against 11 respondents in the death of flight attendant Christine De Serra. The criminal complaint was rejected due to a lack of probable cause. In a medical legal report, the Philippine National Police stated that De Serra died of natural causes after joining a New Year's Eve party with the respondents.
Kahit pa paano, gumana naman ang loob, di ba? Pero sakit pa rin eh.
A court in Manila issues arrest warrants for Philippine State Lottery official Sandra Cam, her son Marco Martin, and five others after they were tagged in the fatal shooting of Batuan Masbate Vice Mayor Charlie Yuson. Yuson was ambushed and killed in Sampaloc, Manila back in 2019. The arrest warrants do not give the suspects any right to bail. Cam has denied any involvement. Martin and Vice Mayor Yuson were rivals in the 2019 local elections. The Office of the Ombudsman has dismissed the criminal and administrative complaints against Manila police officers for detaining suspects in a secret cell with no ventilation. The Human Rights Commission filed those complaints after they found 12 people cramped in what was described as a dark, dingy, and foul-smelling secret enclosure behind a bookshelf during a raid of the Raxabago police station in Tondo back in April of 2017. According to the CHR, the detainees who were unlawfully arrested were not given inquest proceedings, nor were they fed. They were also only to be released if they paid the police. The CHR also noted that since the enclosure had only one male urinal, the detainees were also forced to relieve themselves in plastic bags. However, in a 10-page decision, the ombudsman ruled that there was no proof of bad faith on the part of the authorities when the detainees were placed in those cramped quarters. The ombudsman also noted that the CHR failed to prove that the suspects were held beyond the period allowed by the law and that the cell lacked the necessary basic facilities such as toilets. Now, the Commission on Human Rights vows to exhaust all means necessary to seek justice for those who are unlawfully detained in that secret jail cell in Tondo. Human Rights Commissioner Karen Gumpit hopes that the ombudsman will appreciate the evidence better now that a motion for reconsideration has been filed.
We're extremely disappointed, but again, we are not without hope that this will pan out and this will result in a better appreciation of the evidences that were presented in and submitted with the ombudsman. And the process is not yet final anyway. We still have that motion for reconsideration. Okay. Till the end, to the extent of the justice system, we will go to the end of it.
A former Philippine lawmaker slammed Solicitor General Jose Calida for red-baiting him during the resumption of the Supreme Court's oral arguments on the Anti-Terrorism Act. Mike Navallo reports.
Trust Solicitor General Jose Calida to drop a bombshell each time he faces a big case before the Supreme Court. During his defense of the government's position on the constitutionality of the Anti-Terrorism Act, he red-baited former Bayan Muna Representative Nery Colmenares when he linked him in a raid in Santa Rosa, Laguna, as among the government's victories against communist rebels.
Likewise discovered in the armory were subversive documents, streamers, campaign paraphernalia of Congressman Colmenares, Bayan Muna, and Gabriela, and training materials on advanced revolutionary warfare.
Witnesses and activists who previously occupied the Santa Rosa office raised doubts as to the recovery of firearms and explosives. Colmenares himself did not let it slide.
What's the use, Your Honor, of mentioning my name? This is red tagging then in the end. Your Honor, if in ordinary times red tagging may be considered a libelous statement. But now, Your Honor, red tagging is a deadly offense. It is a threat to life, liberty, and security. The fact that our paraphernalia, if true, were found there, it does not mean we're terrorists. And mentioning us in the opening statement implicates us in that crime, and that is very dangerous for us, Your Honor. and another type of red tagging.
In his opening statement, Kalida cited 16 grounds why the petitions against the Anti-Terrorism Act should be dismissed outright. The passage of the law, he says, is a political question which the court cannot look into. It is an exercise of police power to protect the welfare of the people, and the petitioners questioning it have not suffered any direct injury for them to have any standing to challenge the law. Kalida even cited effects in formal requisites such as verification and certification. He warned nullifying the law will compromise the country's international economic commitments and will endanger our economic survival. Kalida was referring to the anti-money laundering provision under the ATA on the freezing of assets of designated terrorists.
Terrorism must be outlawed in all civilized nations, not explained or rationalized, but fought on and eradicated. My mission as Solicitor General is to see to it that the Anti-Terrorism Act will not be derailed by 37 frivolous lawsuits. Outright dismissal is the only choice available in this case.
But it wasn't Kalida himself who faced interpellation by Associate Justice Rosemary Canandang, the only magistrate who managed to ask questions so far. Two of Kalida's associates bore the brunt of the questioning, quizzed from the definition of terrorism and inciting to terrorism to arrests and detention under the law. Canandang did not go easy on the issue of giving law enforcers wide discretion in interpreting the law, citing various hypothetical situations.
You are in effect admitting that from the example given, the enforcement officers are now given such a wide discretion in apprehending the suspects based only on his own perception of terrorism.
If that police officer does not have personal knowledge on the intent of that person, he can only apprehend him for violation of common crimes, Your Honor.
Despite the OSG's initial position that the government does not conduct surveillance prior to a court authorization, Canandang managed to have the assistant soldier admit that there is informal surveillance.
Again, is it the government position that no surveillance can be done without the CA authorization?
Yes, Your Honor. As provided for in section, this is one of the safeguards provided for by the ATA. This is provided for in section 16, that no surveillance can be undertaken unless there is a written authorization from the Court of Appeals.
Distinguishing this from the informal surveillance being conducted, which is the basis of the intelligence reports gathered.
Yes, Your Honor. This is communication surveillance, Your Honor.
Canandang also sought clarification on the effect of designation.
Designation per se, Your Honor, cannot lead to an arrest or detention. But this without prejudice to the eventual filing of a prescription case, Your Honor.
I think you are not ready to answer this, but I think the question of the court is very clear. You clarify that in the memorandum that the government will submit.
And if the Anti-Terrorism Council can authorize arrest?
Law enforcers would arrest by virtue of a valid warrantless arrest following the guidelines set forth by Rule 113. If the law enforcers have already effected the arrest and they think that they could not file or the evidence are not yet sufficient for them to validly file a case before the prosecutor's office, then they would have to secure a permission from the ATC to detain the person arrested beyond the period contemplated by Article 125 of the revised Penal Code, Your Honor.
So that's the position of the government?
Yes, Your Honor.
And that is not to what is written in the law?
Tuesday's oral arguments was the first conducted online and also Chief Justice Alexander Esmundo's first as top magistrate. The oral arguments will resume on Tuesday. Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.